A very good evening, friends. My name is Dhananjay, and today we are going to start one more chapter in Political Science and International Relations, Indian Government and Politics section. That is, I have completed this previous chapter, the 8th chapter, the economic development of the country after independence. So in this, I am going to discuss the identity politics in India, which is a very important area. At least there will be 115 marker or 120 marker from this section, identity politics in India. So what are the aspects that I am going to cover? In this week, I will be trying to finish this identity politics in India. What do I mean by identity politics? Identity means something which has your or something which is related particularly to our domain. That is, it may be an identity of an individual, or it may be an identity of your group, or it may be an identity of your caste, it may be of your identity of religion, it may be of identity of your ethnicity. So this is what the identity is, and we are going to discuss the identity politics in India. And this comes under the 9th chapter of IGP, paper 1 section B of PSIR. So this is what it has: caste as an identity and its role in Indian politics, and then you have religion and its role in Indian politics, ethnicity and its role in Indian politics. So caste, religion, ethnicity is three things that we are going to cover in identity politics in India. We have to understand this very clearly, because the next chapter is also more or less related to this chapter. So first thing first, let us look at the slides. These two slides, why I have wantedly kept, is they show the diversity of the country. So they has caste, religion. So these are the identities that people will have. Their identities may be on their national, their identities may be on their region, based on their community, profession. It may be based on their caste, community, religion, ethnicity. So this is how they are going to participate whenever there is an event is. So this is what I am going to discuss, identity politics in India. Now, first thing first, we have to understand what is identity politics as such, and then we can enter into individual domains. See, identity means politics of caste, religion and ethnicity, which are given in our syllabus, they belong to identity politics. So we have to understand what is identity. Identity politics is when people of a particular race or ethnicity or gender or religion, they form alliances and organize politically to defend their group interest. So identity politics are the group interest. How these groups are formed? Based on the alliances of caste, religion, ethnicity or gender, or from time to time, right? Race. So these are the identities that individuals have, and they will be basic, or they will be moving on those domains. So identity politics is when people of a particular caste, religion, gender form an alliance and organize politically. They have to organize politically to defend their group interest. So this is what the basic of identity politics is, or the definition of identity politics. The feminist movement, the civil rights movements and the gay liberation movements, what we are seeing across the world or across the country, can be seen as the examples of identity politics, like the women's movement that you might be seeing, civil rights movement, like the rights that farmers are protesting for, then the gay liberation movements like the LGBT rights that they are demanding. So these are the movements that is going to have in the country, or that we are witnessing, and they are mobilizing based on certain identity or type of political organizations. Besides backward class movements like Dalit assertion, movements by minorities. So all these can be said as the identity politics. So whenever we are writing any answer, as far as this point is considered, you can start with what is identity politics, the definition of identity politics. So this you have to by heart. So that is what the point is. Then identity politics is seen to be experiencing a surge in recent times. There is increasing identity based politics, whether it may be caste based politics or religion based politics, it is increasing these days in the country. So we have to see that how they are increasing. It is not only the phenomena of Indian politics, but it is also the phenomena of the global politics. Even in the developed countries, we see these identity politics. The best example is in the United States of America, Black's lives. There is a movement on Black's lives, right? Against the racial discrimination. So this is one movement that we can find it in identity politics. So this is not just developing countries phenomena, but it is also a phenomena of developed countries. Next. How far identity politics is beneficial? Is it beneficial or is it going to create cleavages in the society? So identity politics is debated time and again. People debated that there are positive aspects of identity politics, there are negative aspects of identity politics. So the scholars who supported identity policy says that you have to remember the scholar names. Scholars like Asghar Ali Engineer. Asghar Ali Engineer held that identity politics is an indicator of healthy democracy because it is through identity-based politics vulnerable sections are making an active bid for their share in the political sphere. So identity politics provide a democratic space for the vulnerable sections of the community to enter into the political arena. So Asghar Ali Engineer says identity politics are best for democracy. And he also continues to say that identity politics is not just the assertion of caste or religion or region based identity, but how identity functions as an instrument to access material gains in the power setup. So it is just not your caste or not your religion. It is how you are going to have access to the political structures. So identity is acting as an instrument for these vulnerable sections to go to higher ranks in the political setup. So he supported the identity politics, Asghar Ali Engineer. Identity politics is a healthy indicator of democracy as per Asghar Ali Engineer. Why he says this? Democratic process intensifies power struggle, right? And hence, assertion of various identities assume vital importance in democratic setup. See, whenever there is democracy, which means anyone can participate in the elections or anyone can exercise their franchise. So democracy has given this open opportunity for each and everyone. As a result, the competition will be very tough. Many people will be entering. So it gives chance for the vulnerable sections to form themselves into groups and enter into the domestic policy making through politics. So identity-based politics are very, very vital for a healthy democracy. He also says that identity politics can be seen only in democratic countries. It cannot be seen in authoritative regimes like North Korea, because in authoritative regimes, all the identity politics will be suppressed or subordinated, right? North Korean, you cannot go and have your pressure groups or interest groups or political groups in an authoritative country where monarch will be ruling. So he says that the symbol of identity politics is a symbol of democracy as such. So it cannot be done, but it cannot be done under a democratic regime. Suppression cannot be done in democratic regime, right? So identity politics is the politics of democracy. Democracy is nothing. What do you mean by democracy? It is nothing but giving a free play to power struggle between various sections of people. That is what I said. Democracy is equal access to the political struggle. So the movement identity politics, as per Asghar Ali, they are related to democracy. They are invariably related to democracy, and in the essence, they has the characteristics of democracy as such. Further, the second author or the second scholar who supports identity-based politics is Mr. Kancha Ayalaya. Kancha Ayalaya, he is a professor, and this man says that identity politics are very, very important in a country like India. Because right from independence, democracy was largely confined to upper caste, which means if you look at the political sphere of India, as per Mr. Kancha Ayalaya, he says that it is only the dominant caste or the upper caste who are ruling the country in socio-political economic sphere. Hence, identity politics are very, very vital because it gives an agency of voice to the lower rung of the population to say their or to have their voice to be heard at the socio-economic political angles. So he gave a famous quote saying that neither in the family relations, nor in the market relations, nor in the political relations, has democratization of civil society has truly taken place. Though we have come from 1947, since independence, though we have democracy, but this democracy has not seen in the family relations, in the market relations, in the political relations. The caste system has frozen the mobility in the social structure. The caste system that was present in India right from the ancient time, it was present and it has frozen the social mobility. That means Brahmins, Kshatriya, Sudra, Vaishya, Sudras. This structure itself is very rigid. It has not broken down. As a result, democracy is not visible in the family relationships, in the market relationships, or in the political relationships. So he says that the caste system has frozen mobility in social structures and socio-economic relations. So democratic politics are very important. These political mobilizations therefore need to be read as an attempts to unfreeze the order of things to get the wheel of social mobility turning. This is the best quotation that you can write. So whatever the identity politics is, as per Kancha Ailaya, he said that they are the attempts to unfreeze the order of things in the society so that the democratic wheel of social mobilization goes on continuing, right? The wheel of social mobility continues, whereas the society will be moving towards progression. So that was the point of Mr. Kancha Ailaya. So the first author is Asghar Ali Engineer. Second one is Mr. Kancha Ailaya. You have to remember this quotation and you have to remember this thing. Next, what are the critics of identity politics? Two scholars, I said, critics said that critics of identity politics claim that it only deepens the divide that is existing between the different sections of the group. So critics said that identity politics are very dangerous for the country because it is going to create or exacerbate the already present cleavages in the society. For example, it raises the debate between blacks and whites. It is going to create the debate between straight versus gays, Jews and Arabs, Sunnis versus Shias, Protestants versus Catholics, and so on. So the caste system or the identity politics is going to further exacerbate the cleavages which are already existing in the system as per the critics of the identity politics. Thus, they say that identity politics are very divisive, which means divisive. It is going to divide the society and it is detrimental not only to the development and integrity of the nation, but also to the economic of the nation. So development and integrity of the nations are going to be hurt because of the identity politics as per the critics of identity-based politics. Further moving on with certain other things, if you look at India, in India, the notion of identity politics is rooted in the violent history of partition. Right? If you look at the partition of India, it was rooted in the religious lines. So it was rooted in the demand for a separate electorate. Muslims demanded for a separate electorate. So that was the root cause why the Indian society or the India polity was divided at the time of independence into India and Pakistan. So the notion of identity politics is linked with the partition, which was linked with the violent clashes. As a result, the moment we study about identity politics in India, many people refer to this as the negative, or many people are going to be very criticize the identity politics. So in the minds of Indians, or in the majority of the Indians, identity politics is considered as a criticism. So this is what the meaning is, because we have seen identity politics emerging from the violent clashes of the partition because they were inside the separate electorate format. Therefore, it is very divisive to the threat. It is divisive and threat to the integrity of the nation. We as a nation has been demarcated on the lines of India and Pakistan. This is because of the identity based politics. And then there are scholars like Arun Shauri, who said that use of caste as a political identity threatens the integrity of the nation. How many days you are going to say that, okay, he belongs to this caste. It is going to increase the social cleavages. If you look at the caste fights that is going to happen or that is happening in the Indian society, this is because of the identity politics that these castes are exerting. If you look at the Jats in Haryana, or if you look at the other Yadava communities, or if you look at the Maratha fight that is going to happen, these are all caste-based movements which are happening. And as for Arun Shori, he is also a critic of identity politics, saying that it is going to create or threaten the integrity of the nation. Identity politics keep on resurfacing in the form of caste-based reservations, and the moment one section is getting reservations and the merit is compromised, then people are going to revolt. As a result, the social discord is going to be very visible. So this is what Mr. Arun Shori says. So I am speaking about criticisms of identity politics. So what I said, criticisms, it is going to increase the cleavages. It is going to have, as per Arun Shori, is one scholar. Then there is one more scholar called R.K. Debarma. R.K. Debarma, he says that identity politics evolve from the uncritical evaluation of the self. If identity politics is going to evolve from the uncritical evaluation of the self, then it is going to be self-defeating. What do this statement mean? If identity politics are emerging, say on the basis of caste, and if this is done without thinking why caste movement has to take place or why there has to be reservations based on caste, if this is, there is no rational thinking and still you are fighting, then definitely it is going to be self-defeating. This is because the politics of the oppressed mirrors the politics of the oppressor in certain instances. See, this is a famous statement which Debarma said. The politics of the oppressed mirrors the politics of the oppressor in certain instances. What do this mean? What do this statement mean? See, for example, if there is caste-based reservations, and if these reservations are not evaluated properly, if it is not based on self-evaluation, then it is going to be self-defeating. Because in the caste reservations itself, the higher the inside the caste itself, only few people will be getting benefited, and the vulnerable sections in that caste are going to be at loss. This is what the concept is. That is why even in India, if you look at SCs and STs, even though they are having reservations, but that reservations are not reaching to the people in that caste itself who are in the vital need. Only certain section or the creamy layer of that caste is garnering all the benefits. So this says that the oppressed mirrors, the politics of the oppressed mirrors of the politics of the oppressors. What does this mean? Say, for example, if there is one organization, that is Brahmins and SCs, then this scheduled caste movement or identity politics based on the caste has evolved. And if this is not introspecting in itself, then obviously the higher rung in this section is going to oppress the lower rung. As the Brahmins used to oppress SCs, the higher SCs are going to oppress the lower caste SCs, lower rung SCs. So what do this mean? The politics of the mirrors, the politics of the oppressed mirrors the politics of the oppressor in certain terms. The politics of the oppressed is going to mirror the politics of the oppressor. So that is what the meaning is. I think this point is very clear, that you have to understand. Politics of the oppressed mirrors the politics of the oppressor in certain forms, if it is not based on the self-evaluation. However, if an identity that is meant to be a site of resistance for a community becomes oppressive to the very people it is trying to emancipate, then by replicating the structures of oppressor, then one has to re-examine the boundaries of the identity itself. What this person is telling, again the same thing. If the identity, why this caste-based identity is formed? Because they are getting oppressed from certain other caste. Say the same example. This is scheduled caste, this is Brahmins. Why scheduled castes are organizing themselves on the basis of identity? Because they are getting oppressed from Brahmins. As a result, they have organized themselves into one identity that is called scheduled caste identity, and they are mobilizing. But if the same community is going to become oppressive on the lower rung of the community, then definitely you have to understand the boundaries, or you have to understand how far identity politics is really helping the required sections of the community. So what do this mean? Deverma clearly says that identity politics has to have a re-examination, and it has to look whether the oppressed politics is being mirrored by the oppressor again by themselves. So this is what the concept is. So R.K. Deverma is one other person who says that identity politics needs self-re-evaluation. Then one more strongest criticism of identity politics is that it is going to fetishize. What is this fetishism? It is going to increase a sense of deep belonging, or a sense of deep thinking that historical injustices suffered from the communities, which can perhaps contribute to the fossilization of beliefs that has been referred to the above. Now, you have to use these type of things, because identity politics is going to fetishize the historical injustices. It is going to create or fetishize the historical injustices that the communities have suffered, and it is going to fossilize that belief. What do these two keywords mean? The keywords mean that why identity politics are formed? Because of the historical injustice that they have meted. To explain you very simply, I'll take again the scheduled caste example. Now, scheduled caste are organizing themselves as a particular organization, right? As an alternative to the Brahmins or the Kshatriyas, right? Now, identity politics, you are differentiating people based on this identity, like these are SCs, these are STs. Based on which lines? Based on the lines that they were historically unjustified, or historically injustice was meted to them. The moment you are basing your division on these historical divisions, that is historical lines, then the people of this community is going to feel, yes, we are historically unjustified. As a result, we have to continue this identity politics. And this belief of historical injustice is going to get fossilized forever. Which means, if the reservation system is continuing in 1947, people still think that even in 2020, reservation has to be continued in the same format, because they have fossilized a belief in themselves, thinking that, yes, we have been suppressed for millions of years, we have to have reservation. There will be no reform in the self-identity based politics because of these fossilization beliefs, because people have get fetishized to the belief that they were suppressed for millions of years. So this is the concept. What do I mean by this? Historical injustices suffered by the communities can reflect and can contribute to the fossilization of these beliefs. So these are the key terms that you can use. So these are the criticisms. Through this way, this is going to create cleavages in the society. So I have said, what are the advantage? What are identity politics? I said, what are the advantages of identity politics by mentioning two scholars? Then I also said, what are the disadvantages of identity politics by telling the examples of Arun Shauri, R.K. Deverma, and then I said the historical injustices, fetishization of beliefs, and the fossilization of beliefs, right? This is what I said. Now, then what is the middle path? At one point, identity politics has positive connotation. On the other point, identity politics have negative connotations. Then what is the middle path? It says that identity politics, a way forward is that it has to be situated historically, but a view of future. Yes, you can give reservations because historically you were suppressed. But what about your future? Is it going to continue forever in the similar format? It has to have a view of the future by considering the historical actuated. So it has to be situated in the future, no doubt, in the history, no doubt, but it has to have certain vision in the future. The purpose of organizing under any identity in the present is to overcome the historical injustice. If you are organizing yourself in the form of a separate caste or a religion or ethnicity, this is just because you want to overcome the historical injustice that is meted to you. The moment that objective is met, definitely you have to overcome that identity politics and you have to go for a egalitarian society. That is the point is. So in the future, when the objectives outlined by the present political project has been achieved, then identity politics should not be no more relevant. So what is this point? So to explain these three things, say for example, if reservation system is being provided, yes, reservation systems has to be provided because by keeping in mind the historical injustice that were meted to them. But at the same time, in future, if this objective of reservations or if this objective for providing reservations is met, then definitely reservations has to be given a relook. So that is what the way forward for identity politics is. Identity politics, it has in such way, it will be having positive aspect and it will be nullifying the negative aspect. So this is what the way forward is. So this is what the identity politics is. So whenever they ask a question on role of religion, caste or ethnicity, you start your answer with the identity politics. Identity politics, what is definition? What are the advantages? What are the disadvantages? What is the way forward? You can write in these four things in any answer of caste, religion, ethnicity, but the term has to differ. If here I am using identity politics, next line I will be using caste, in the next place I will be using religion, in the next place I will be using ethnicity. But the theme of argument is the same thing. You got the point, I think. So I am just repeating again, identity politics is any politics that will be associated with your understanding. Either it is a group or either it is a caste, religion, community, race, ethnicity, whatever it is. So these are identity politics. If you are mobilizing people for your political gains to achieve the interests of the identity group, then definitely that is identity politics. It will have advantages, it will have disadvantages, it will have to be balanced at one point of time. So in the next coming discussions, I am going to discuss role of caste, what are the positive aspects, what are the negative aspects, what is the balancing point. Role of religion, what are the positive aspects, what are the negative aspects, and what is the balancing point. Role of ethnicity, what are the bad positive, what are the negative aspects, and then what is the balancing point. So this has to be our answer writing whenever we are discussing about identity based politics. So let me move quickly to the caste as an identity. Role of caste in Indian politics. Caste is one identity that was given in the exam in the syllabus. So as far as caste as identity is considered, we have to look at what is caste, what are the basics of caste, we have to understand certain elements of caste, and then we can discuss how caste is playing its role in the Indian politics. So we have to understand caste as such, and then we can understand role of caste. For this, I have given this slide because these two are the scholars, socialist scholars, one from India, the other one is from Louis Dumont, from Western scholar. So they have given their idea on the Indian caste system. Indian caste system. So we have to understand Indian caste system and how, what are the arguments of the so-called Louis Dumont and as well as M.N. Srinivasan. M.N. Srinivasan has given one concept that is called the dominant caste. We will study what is this dominant caste as per M.N. Srinivasan, and there is also one more thing called social change in modern India. What are the Louis Dumont's concepts and how M.N. Srinivasan has countered these arguments through his concept. So this is what the point is. Remember these two names and if possible remember their books also. Louis Dumont, Homo Hierarchicus is the book of Louis Dumont, whereas M.N. Srinivasan, he has particularly spoke about how social change has happened, or caste has reiterated itself to the modern times and then reiterated or readjusted itself to the demands of the modern times. And then he has also given a concept of dominant caste. This is what we have to understand in the few slides of the next. I am going to discuss those things. caste in Indian politics. What are we going to study in this? I am going to explain what is the meaning of caste, what is the social construct. I am going to see or explain you what is the difference between these two things called caste as well as class. Class versus caste debate is the debate which exists between the Louis Dumont as well as the M.N. Srinivasan that we are going to see. And then we will look at what is the history of caste politics in India. We will also see what is the role that caste has played in Indian politics. And then I will be looking at caste as a determinant of electoral behavior, right? And then I will be looking at OBC politics, Dalit politics, and its impact on Congress system, right? How Congress party has benefited or it has been minimized because of the rise of OBC politics or Dalit politics, that we will look. So these are the dimensions that I am going to cover in caste in Indian politics, right? So we have to understand this to write the answer. So caste basics. What do I mean by caste, or what do you understand by caste? See, in India, caste is nothing but jati. J-A-T-I, jati. In Indian context, what we call it as is jati. But in West, the jati is nothing but caste. There is no exact term for jati in English. As a result, we compare Indian jati to the caste system. So there is no exact translation of the Indian term jati in European language. So Oxford language doesn't have the term called jati. Jati is a Indian text, right? Colonial masters, as a result, for jati, they used this word called caste. So British started understanding the concept of jati in the terms of caste, in the practice of jati, right? And what do caste mean? It is a Portuguese word. This is not Indian word. Indian word is jati. So colonials thought themselves, okay, this jati is related to the Portuguese concept of casta. What do casta mean? Casta means pure blood, which means race. So caste is coming in relation to the race. So Britishers started comparing jati to the race, jati to the caste. So you can say jati in Indian context is equivalent to the race or to that of the caste in the Western politics or Western dictionaries. The Western world equates, the Western world equates casteism with racism. So if you look at this thing, there exists racism in West, and then in the India you have caste. So racism is Western concept, casteism is an Indian concept. So this is what the caste is. And then if you look at Indian freedom struggle, our freedom struggle or freedom fighters said that this is the fight against anti-colonialism and anti-racialism as the fundamental objectives of India's foreign policy. After independence, we made the foreign policy, the Nehruvian foreign policy, is anti-colonialism, anti-racialism. That is why we supported the colonial states, those countries which were under the colonial rule, like South Africa, Latin American countries, right? So our foreign policy was anti-colonialism and anti-racialism. So we started blaming the West, or the Indians started blaming the West, said that in that phenomena, saying that so West followed racism, West followed colonialism. Now the moment we started criticizing the West, West started criticizing the Indians, saying that, okay, you are saying that we are colonial, we are racial, but what about your society? Your society, you are following the worst form of racialism, worst form of apartheid, in the form of racial segregation. In the terms of caste, in the name of caste, you are segregating your men into higher caste and lower caste, and this is what the real apartheid is. So first you look into your context and then you can blame us. This was the strong opposition that was said by the Western scholars and the Indian society. So this is what the concept is. So In this comes the person called Louis Dumont. Louis Dumont has described caste system as Indian model of social stratification, which is opposite to the Western model of social stratification based on class. So Louis Dumont came out with his concept and said that Indians have this concept called caste, whereas Western countries has class. And he said that concept of class is more advanced than the concept of caste. So Louis Dumont started telling that though India is projecting that its foreign policy is anti-colonialism as anti-racialism, but still it follows certain base or certain social stratification called caste, which is opposite to the stratification of class. He says that whenever there is class stratification, then it is advanced stratification compared to the caste classification. We'll see why this debate was started by Louis Dumont. The debate between caste and class. Louis Dumont said, in class, the status is determined by the merit. In caste, it is determined by the birth. So he is telling that the first difference between class and caste is, so you will be given your status based on the merit that you possess, not on the birth. If you are a Brahmin, you are going to be a Veda reader. If you are a Sudra, then you are going to work in the menial job. But in the West, as per Louis Dumont, your status is being described on the basis of your merit and not on the basis of your birth. This is the first difference as per Louis Dumont. The second thing is the economic criteria is used when people are classified in different classes. In class, you can divide people based on your economic criteria. But Louis Dumont says, in the form of caste, the notion of purity and pollution is used in identifying the status of caste system. What do this mean? Brahmins were considered as pure. As a result, they were given higher position in the economic terms or in the economic activity. Sudras were considered as pollutants or pollution. As a result, they were given lower rung in their economic activities. So in the caste system, as per Louis Dumont, your what is going to determine is purity and pollution rather than your economic status. So class determines the status based on your economic activity. Caste, on the other hand, is going to determine on the basis of your purity and pollution concept. Again, this is all about Louis Dumont concepts. Next, he says that class system is open and any person can move from lower caste to higher class. This is very flexible. You can move from lower class to higher class. But on the caste system, it is very rigid. It cannot be jumped. People cannot move from lower caste to higher caste. But in class, you can move from lower class to higher class. Because social stratification is very rigid in Indian society in the form of caste. So this is how he criticized the Indian concept of casteism and said that the Western concept of class is far, far, far better than the Indian concept of casteism. Hence, Indian foreign policy should not be treating the foreign policy such as anti-racialism or anti-apartheid. But India has itself an apartheid society, so it has to look into this society. That was the argument made by Louis Dumont in his book, What I Said. Homo Hierarchius. So this was the discussion that he made. Class versus caste debate. Now there is one gentleman called M.N. Srinivasan from India. He is going to counter these arguments that we will see here. M.N. Srinivasan has challenged this system. That is called Louis Dumont's perspective. According to M.N. Srinivasan, Dumont's approach is very, very textual. It is not practical, it was textual or theoretical. In practice, there is no much difference between the concept of West and the concept of East or the Indian. Class is as static as caste. Though Dumont is telling that class is very flexible, but if you look at the practical reality of the Western society, class is as rigid as the class is as rigid as the caste of Indian society. So he said that your flexibility approach has been proven wrong in practicality. Class is based on the birth as caste. So he again says that if you look at the practical working condition of the Western countries, class is based on the birth of the person. It is not on the merit. So he says that your point is wrong. And the third thing is the Indian caste system is not entirely rigid as claimed by Dumont. He said that mobility was permitted at point of time. So in India, if you study the practical situation of India, Indians have seen the caste mobilization or the social stratification getting mobilized at point of time. So this, he, to prove this point, he said the term called Sanskritization. So he gave a new term called Sanskritization, which means persons of lower caste has adapted practices of Brahmins. They started learning Sanskrit. They started learning the Vedas. They started following the principles of Brahmins, such as eating vegetarianism or avoiding non-vegetarianism and reducing the pollution by following the concept of not eating the non-veg, and then they were elevated to the higher status. So this was one concept called Sanskritization. M.N. Srinivasan has given the concept of Sanskritization and proved the point that there was a social mobility inside the caste system also. And he said many examples like Sudras who were elevated to Kshatriyas. So this is, he said many examples like many Sudras were elevated to the status of Kshatriyas. There are also examples where untouchables were where untouchables has been Sanskritized. For example, Jatavas in Agra. In Agra, these were the untouchables. So they were Sanskritized. So this system used to continue even in the ancient times and medieval times. It is only after the point of reservations has been introduced, they were de-Sanskritized. What do I mean by this? The caste system started getting more rigid only after the reservation systems were announced in the country. So by this point, he said that caste and class are almost equal terms or almost equal concepts. At the same time, caste is not rigid. He used the term Sanskritization. Apart from that, he has also made a very clear difference between the dominant caste and the upper caste. The concept of dominant caste has been given by M.N. Srinivasan. This is the slide that I have kept. This is the book that I have kept in that slide, right? M.N. Srinivasan has given the concept of dominant caste. He says that the term upper caste is misleading. There is no term called upper caste for Indian politics. This is the dominant caste which is playing a vital role in Indian politics. We will see what is the dominant caste is. We have to understand the role of dominant caste in India. We are just limiting ourselves to the upper caste, but this is not the upper caste which is determining the political system. It is the dominant caste in India. We have to understand this in order to understand the country. So dominant caste, as per M.N. Srinivasan, is those caste who are holding the economic powers, the social powers, and the political powers. So M.N. Srinivasan clearly says that dominant castes in India are different from the upper caste, like Brahmin, Kshatriya, Sudra, Vaishya. So these are not the upper caste that we find. But dominant caste is one thing. What is dominant caste? Those caste who has economic power, social power, and political power. Then we call it as the dominant caste. In most of the situations, as per M.N. Srinivasan, castes like Brahmins and Kshatriyas are not dominant caste. If you look at the Indian political system also, which are functioning, Brahmins doesn't have much political say. Kshatriyas doesn't have political say. It is the dominant caste which have the political say. What are those dominant caste? The caste which has political power, the caste which has economic power, the caste which has social power. So if you look at the present Indian context, it is not the upper caste hierarchy, rather it is the dominant caste hierarchy which is playing a crucial role in determining the social strata of the India. So this was the concept of dominant caste as per M.N. Srinivasan. and he has set certain characteristics. M.N. Srinivasan defined the term dominant caste to refer to those castes in the villages who are numerically strong and they have highest number of political power. In the year 1987, he has given the concept of dominant caste. And why he has used this concept of dominant caste? To determine or to refer to those castes in the villages who are numerically very strong. Whoever are numerically strong in the villages, he has used the term called dominant caste. So dominant caste have three characteristics. They are land owners, they are numerical majority, and they have social status, and they are going to determine the politics. So the concept of dominant caste, the concept of Sanskritization, these are the words which were given by M.N. Srinivasan. He is the person who has countered the Louis Dumont concept of class and caste, and he has equated class with caste, and he has also said that the rigidity in the Indian caste system is not as said by Louis Dumont, but it is very flexible also at point of times. So he has also given some examples of dominant caste. The examples of dominant caste are Yadavas are the dominant caste in Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. Jats are the dominant caste in Haryana and Western Uttar Pradesh. Marathas are the dominant caste in Maharashtra. Reddi, Kamma, Kapu are the dominant caste in Andhra Pradesh. Lingayats, Okkalingas are the dominant caste in Karnataka. It is not just Brahmins. So the traditional notion of upper caste has no relevance or least relevance, but we have to study the role of dominant caste, not the upper caste, in Indian politics. So this was the point. So who are the dominant caste? If you go to UP and Bihar, it is Yadavas. If you go to Haryana and Western Uttar Pradesh, it is Jats. If you come to Maharashtra, it is Marathas. If you come to Andhra Pradesh, it is Reddis, Kammas and Kapus. And then in Karnataka, it was Okkaligas and Lingayats. So this is what the basic definition of caste, and this is what the argument of caste is. I have discussed so far what is identity politics, that is one separate thing, and I have started the role of caste in Indian politics. For that, we have to understand basics, such as what is caste, what is the debate between caste and class, what is the arguments of Louis Dumont, and I also said how Mr. Srinivasan has countered those things, and the concepts of Sanskritization and the concept of dominant caste. As per M.N. Srinivasan, it is the dominant caste system that we have to understand, not just the upper caste system, in order to understand the clear reality of role of caste in Indian politics. Now we will look at the history of caste in Indian politics. History of caste politics in India. How caste started reflecting in Indian politics. So caste started its role during independence times, that is pre-independent era and post-independent era. So caste itself has a history of Indian politics, that is before independence as well as post-independence. Before independence, if you look at the ancient India itself, caste is associated with the politics. How it is associated? Hinduism is nothing but it was an alliance between Brahmins and Kshatriyas. Kshatriyas used to be the political forces, whereas they are used to rule based on the Brahmins, Brahmin teachings, right? Brahmins used to guide the king and king used to follow the advice of Brahmins. So this shows that there was certain caste politics which were determining role of caste is present even during the times of ancient times. And if you look at Buddhism also, what is Buddhism? Buddhism is an alliance between Vaishyas and Kshatriyas. In order to counter the dominance of Brahmins, Buddhism has evolved, and this was the collaboration between Vaishyas and Shudras that Buddhism has been prominent. So ancient history itself shows that India has the role of caste being prominent in determining the shape of the political system at that point of time. Now, when the Britishers has arrived, Britishers also promoted caste politics. How they promoted caste politics? They have conducted the caste survey, and the most important thing is Ramsay MacDonald, he has given the concept of communal award And he has come out with the concept of separate electorate for Hindus. Why he has come out with this? To divide the Hindu society. So caste became prominent even during the time of the British. So it is not only during the time of the ancient Indian history or medieval Indian history, even during the time of Britishers wantedly, they incorporated divide and rule policies through separate electorate for Dalits by imposing or by coming out with communal award. And not only this, the political parties during the national movement were the parties of different caste. If you look at the Indian political system also, Indian political party system also, they were based on different caste. Like Congress used to be dominant with Brahmins during the time of independence, and the Justice Party and DK parties were that of OBCs, and then Republican Party was of Dalits. So if you look at these political systems, then obviously they were based on the lines of caste. So historically, caste has its role at the ancient times, at the medieval times, at the modern times, at the times of the British times, at the times of our political parties also were based on certain caste dominance. So caste is not a new phenomena in Indian politics. It has been historically present. However, after the independence, if you look at the role of history of caste politics, after independence, the Constitution of India has not abolished the caste system. Why it has not abolished? It has maintained caste as a base for distributive justice or affirmative action. Right? How Article 15 and Article 16? Article 15 and Article 16 clearly says that there has to be certain reservations for SCs and STs. Based on the caste itself, the Constitution of India has provided the redistribution policies or the affirmative actions. So, Constitution has given a firm ground for caste politics in India. So, whatever the policies that the government is going to make, that has to be made on these lines. So, even after independence, Constitution played a crucial role in the caste system. Caste continues to play a prominent role in the elections, formation of political parties, right? That is very visible today. Every political party, particularly that of the special regional parties, are the parties of particular caste. If you look at the regional parties in various countries or various parts of the state, they were based on the party lines, the particular caste lines. So linguistic reorganization, which has taken place after independence, the Green Revolution, which has followed, and the Mandal Commission in 1990s has strengthened the caste politics. We will see how linguistic reorganization, how Green Revolution, how Mandal Commission has played a very crucial role in deepening the caste politics. So further, the beginning of coalition politics in 1989 has increased the regionalization of Indian party system. That is, more and more regional parties started playing a crucial role at the center. That is, for the first time in the year 1989, the regional parties formed coalition government at the center. Because of this coalition government at the center, these regionalization of political parties has happened and more caste has evolved, which means greater role of caste in Indian politics. The role of caste in Indian politics is called by a great term called Mandalization of Indian politics. This you have to remember. Mandalization of Indian politics. What do you mean by Mandalization of politics? After the Mandal Commission report, we were divided into the Mandal Commission has given special reservations for OBCs, Dalits, right? That you have to understand. And based on this, particularly the OBCs, sorry, not Dalits, Mandalization of Indian politics, OBCs has become more prominent in the caste system. This means Indian politics is known for Mandalization of Indian politics. We can categorize Indian caste into three prominent groups. That is the upper caste, the OBCs, and the Dalits. So this is what the discussion is. So what I said, identity politics, what are the basis for identity politics, basics of identity politics, definition of identity politics, what are the positives of perspectives, positive perspectives, negative perspectives, and what is the way forward. This is the basic for writing any answer on regional this. And then I said, what is caste and what are the aspects of caste? caste versus class debate on dominant caste. And then I said history of caste politics in India. In the history of caste politics, I said pre-independence, post-independence. In the post-independence period also, I said 1989, after 1989, mandalization of politics has taken place, and that mandalization resulted into three groups, that is upper caste, OBCs and Dalits. So we have to see OBC role, Dalit role, the decline of Congress system, and the other aspects of caste. So this is the first basic aspects that we have to understand. In my next class, I am going to discuss in depth about the caste system of India and the role of caste in Indian politics. Thank you. Thank you. If you have any doubts, you can mail me at this, and you can also subscribe to our Telegram group, where we will be uploading the answers, where we will be uploading the notes in PPT format. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Have a nice day.